My name is Bill. It's my honor to be here. I've made a very big mistake. I had lunch. I had southern food. And I am crying like a tiny baby as I ate the food. I'm still crying now. You guys in the South, you really know how to cook, huh? Still crying. Who am I to stand here in front of you? I started life as an accountant with Virgin and with Richard Branson. I was employee 33 in Virgin. I then made the biggest mistake of my life, and I left Virgin and moved into investment banking. If I thought I was a very bad accountant, I was a very, very, very bad investment banker. I then became very lucky. I sold my business to a Wall Street bank and I retired. It then became obvious to me that actually finding funding for businesses is incredibly complicated. And it doesn't have to be. I suppose I should start with what Angels Den does. We are a business that's been going 9 years. We sit in the middle between people who have a very large sum of money and businesses that are looking to grow and extend their reach across the world. And equity funding is where the rich people, the high net worths, the business angels, invest their money in exchange for a proportion, a percentage of the business. So our average deal size is $300,000 for an 18% stake in the business. So they give you $300,000 and you give them an 18% stake in your business. I mean, it doesn't have to be like that. That's just how it actually works out. But why would you actually want to do that? Why would that be important? No one is more surprised than me that 9 years later, we're in 10 countries across the world, and we have 17,000 angels at our disposal across the world. So that's 17,000 people who have a minimum amount of $500,000 that if they lost it, they would be upset, but it wouldn't kill them, like the lunch did to me. They'd be upset. Last year, we did slightly over 5,000 business pitches. So if anybody wants to come and talk to me about how not to pitch your business, then I'm an expert. If anybody wants to come and talk to me about what the business plan should look like, then I'm an expert. If anybody wants to know a whole bunch of things, I can tell you. But here, I'm going to tell you about why some companies get funded and why companies do not get funded. I suppose when we started off, we didn't particularly understand this either. We didn't understand that not all money is the same. So there are many banks here today that are graciously sponsoring us along the top, and banks will give you money under certain circumstances. Venture capitalists will give you money under certain circumstances. There are crowdfunding companies in Thailand and across the world, and they will give you money. But that money is different from banking money, from angel money, from VC money. And it's different in a number of different ways. Because we see slightly over, well, what are we doing? We see 110 business plans every day. And all 110 of those business plans ask us for the wrong thing. They all ask us for money. Whereas, in fact, what most businesses really need is mentorship. What businesses really need is business contacts. What businesses then need is business experience. And then you need the money. And I think that's kind of an easy concept, but it's also a difficult concept, especially for startups and especially when you're just starting your startup. It's difficult to actually appreciate what it is that you do not know. And thus, one of the huge benefits that a business angel comes with is that they put their money into the deal, but they also give you their mentorship, their time, and their experience, as well as their business contacts. And the contacts, I would say, are probably 100 times more valuable than any money that they can give you. The other motivation for these guys putting the money in is that they don't want to lose their money because they're not stupid. They are many things, but they are not stupid. So if nothing else, their egos will make sure that they do not lose money. And if they don't lose money, then you're not going to lose money either. And I think it's a difficult concept, as I say. I think it's because people don't understand, as I say, what it is that you don't understand. And that's why people like me fly across the world from London. Don't get me wrong, I'm enjoying myself. It's great. Even though my head hurts this morning. Thank you, Adam. Yeah, I'm still crying. If you don't understand the concept, or if you're still thinking that all money is the same, or that crowdfunding is going to be able to help you in your deal, then perhaps at the end, I hope I will change your mind. Because it's not about getting the money on board. We have never seen so much money. There is no shortage of money. Absolutely no shortage of money. In 9 years, we've never seen so much money. If all you want to do is just get the money on board, there are many, many easier avenues than getting an angel on board as well. And I'm going to tell you about the mistakes that people have made that we have witnessed. I'm going to tell you about how not to do it. I'm going to tell you how to do it. I'm an entrepreneur. That means I'm attention deficit. That means I get bored very easily. That means I don't particularly like detail. If you don't understand shareholders' agreements and nominee structures and memorandums and arts and whatever Thai legislation says that you need to have to be able to set up your company, then you will probably fail. It is crushingly boring. Any lawyers in here today? Even lawyers will admit it's crushingly boring, but it's absolutely essential. This is your company. This is what you're going to spend the next 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years building. And if you don't understand the legal documents that are behind it, then you will die. And die a horrible death. And you can get the money on board very easily. That's not necessarily the difficult thing. The difficulty is, as with a pre-marriage nuptial agreement or any sort of contract, you only need to use it when things are going wrong. And when things are going wrong, you'd better understand what the significant parts behind it are and how legally that's going to affect you, especially when you're giving a proportion of your business away. Male entrepreneurs in the audience, get a lawyer that you trust. Women will bother to read the documentation. Women have a very different sort of approach to setting up a company in as much as it is a part of them. They become emotionally attached to it in a way that a guy cannot understand. Women will read the documentation and then they will understand it. One of the reasons that women do not go into entrepreneurship to the extent, but I'm very pleased to see there's probably more female entrepreneurs in the audience than there are males, which is great. In Britain, it's about 14%. 14% of all the businesses are going to be set up by women. Women make much better entrepreneurs. They make much better angels. But we'll come on to that in a minute. We make the distinction, and I think it's often they're called investors, they're called angel investors, they're called angels, they're called VCs. So many of the businesses I see, especially who have been American trained, their whole job is to get VC funding on board. They really, really want to get VC funding on board, but often these people don't necessarily understand exactly what that means. They do. Invest in property, you probably won't go wrong. Angels are coming at it from a different perspective, and that's what my company does. Angels know that there is something else that they could do with their money, and they are looking to invest between 8 and 9% of their total wealth with us. 91, 92% of their wealth is in stocks, bonds, property, gold, cars, wine. That's stuff that makes them their money. The 8 to 9% has a different motivation. And we'll cover that again. And it's important that you understand what the motivation of someone who's going to be a part of your company is. It's like employing a member of staff without a job description. It's like employing a member of staff. You don't know what they really want to do. If you're going to get an investor or an angel on board and you're not sure what their motivation is, you're stupid and you will die. And you will go out of business. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong at all about going out of business. But if you want to go out of business, this is a very good way of doing it. So why? Why do angels invest, I suppose, is the $64,000 question. It took us 22 months to figure that out. And for 22 months, we assumed, which is the enemy of all entrepreneurship, we assumed that angels were investing to make money. And then we did something very clever, which allows me to fly around the world and address wonderful audiences like you, so I can show off and see how clever I am, to find out what their motivation for investing was. Do you know what we did? We asked them, why are you investing? We had 2,100 angels at the time. Making money came in at number 3. I've told you already, if you want to guarantee making money, invest into property. Number 2 was about giving something back to younger people, not allowing you to make the mistakes that they themselves have made, because 91% of them are male, is going to be ego. See that company over there? I've invested in that. See that company? That's mine. That's mine. And in the golf club, that's really exciting. It's about altruism. Sorry, that's a difficult word. Guys, you guys rock in the interpretation booth. I'm amazed at you guys. So cool. I can barely speak English, never mind 3 languages. But the number one reason, so number 2 was that collection of things and a whole bunch of other tiny little things, but that was effectively it. The number one reason that angels are looking to invest into your business is that this is what gets them out of bed in the morning. And across the world, that holds true for almost every 80-something% of all the angels that we see, every angel that we talk to. Now, we're in Mexico, we're in Germany, we're in Hong Kong, Malaysia, we're in Singapore, we're in right across the Middle East. Who cares? The one place that we're not is in America, because in America, where I lecture, this doesn't resonate. They don't understand this. They will go, "Bill, you're talking nonsense." There are three reasons that I invest as an American angel: to make money, to make money, and see where I'm going? To make money. The only reason that Americans do it. And that's fine, it's not necessarily a bad reason. But the whole American ethos is about investing across a portfolio of deals. So everyone knows that 80% of startups fail. So thus, I'm going to invest in 10 deals. 8 of them are going to collapse. One of them is going to go a bit meh. And one of them will pay back all the money that I have made. And nowhere else in the world do we hear that. Only American-trained investors come up with that nonsense. Another way of looking at that is that everybody adopted that, and these are investors, these are not necessarily angels, okay? I hope you're beginning to get the point. So what they do is that they give you the money, and then what do? They walk away. They go, "Good luck, buddy. Come back to me with your results. Nice to see you. Okay, don't talk to me." It's not necessarily a bad way of doing it, but it ensures that they will lose 80% of the money. Why? Going back to the first statement I gave you, because what you guys really need is not money. What you really need is mentorship and direction. Here in Thailand, there's no shortage of money, and there's no shortage of entrepreneurs. I was also honored to attend the Bangkok startup exhibition. Amazing, amazing, the energy that I saw in the room. The one thing that Thailand does not have enough of is mentors. And mentors play an incredibly... No. Mentors play a vital role in the ecosystem. Angels will also invest into deals and mentor you. That is what it's about. That is the difference between the American model, where people invest into deals on... These are startups. These are high-risk ventures. But they are intelligent business people. They're so intelligent that they understand this. They understand that a spray and pray model doesn't bring them the rewards that they do. And another way of looking at the American model is that 80% of the companies I see before me will get funded because there's no shortage of money, but 80% of you will go out of business. Now, 80% of that pain, and you'll each have spent 23 months on average before you go out of business, do the math, that is a lot of energy. A lot of energy to waste, and I'm going to tell you how you can avoid that. As I say, we see 110 business plans a day. 60, 70 of them are going to be just ideas. I've just got an idea. Go away. It's a lovely idea, but ideas are 10 a dime. Very few people are going to fund an idea. The difference between a business and an idea is that you have attached controls, systems, and processes to your idea to monetize that idea. You are able to get sales on board. If you haven't got sales yet, it's going to be very difficult for you to attract the money that you need to grow. And then people say, do you know what? I actually need to get the funding on board so I can get the sales. How can I do that? Welcome to the world of entrepreneurship. No one said it was going to be easy. If it was that easy, everyone would be doing your startup. Seriously. You need to bootstrap. You need to get your friends and family. You need to use your savings. I don't have any savings. Then you're never going to make an entrepreneur. Or it's going to take you a very, very long time. You need to get to a stage when you've got sales. If you don't have sales, then you would have to sell a proportion of your business at an inflated rate. You would have to give away more equity in your business than you should to de-risk it for an investor or an angel. Why would an angel invest into your business just because it's a good idea when he could invest into a business that's done the most difficult thing you guys will ever do? And the most difficult thing is sell something. Sell the first piece of product, the first thing you can actually do. By far and away, the most difficult thing. I'm not talking about minimal viable products. I'm not talking about pivoting and lean startups and whatever. Just sell something. If you haven't sold something yet, then you need to direct all of your energies to actually getting there. Otherwise, an angel's going to find it very difficult. So, the most difficult question that we meet, that we say to the people that we meet, so we're now down to about 30 a week. So in Mexico City or in Berlin or whatever, we meet people, and here it comes. Here is the most difficult question. It is, dude, great to meet you. Tell me about your business. Don't worry, you don't have to. Tell me about your business. 36% of people in Hong Kong, in London, in Edinburgh, fail to be able to explain to a normal human being what it is that they do. Geeks are almost incapable of being able to explain to normal human beings what it is that they do. And it is as if a verse from the Quran has hit them in the head when they go, what? You mean someone has to understand my business before they're going to invest? They're going, yeah. I mean, yeah. They're going, wow. Oh, when you put it like that, oh, I never actually thought about it like that before. So people have to understand. Yes. Yes, they have to understand your business. 36% of people. Geeks, then comes academics. The number one piece of advice for academics looking to raise capital, get someone with communication skills to do it for you. Incubators are a vital part of any ecosystem. I am so pleased to see what is happening here. And once again, it is very easy to set up an incubator. Badly, incubators are the beating heart of any entrepreneurial ecosystem. The number one thing that every incubator will teach you on day one, no, to even get into the incubator, what do you have to do? You have to be able to explain to people what it is that you do. I sit and judge. I'm judging on the beach. I'm looking forward to that. Yeah. I've got shorts as well. It's going to be cool. I judge lots of incubators, lots of panels about taking incubators on all right across the world. That's what makes me such an interesting person. I've met three companies over. Whilst they're a great thing, they're also a bad thing. Because people living in that paradigm all learn to talk a funny language that only they understand. FinTech incubators, that I spend too much time in, I have no idea what they are talking about. If you cannot write your own business plan, then you're dead. Some people go, no, I've got an accountant or I've paid someone a very large, you're stupid. You're stupid and you can't do this. This is the easy bit. This is the easy bit. You need to be able to communicate what you do and then write it down on a piece of paper with some forecasty things and some idea about how it's going to happen. No one's going to read it. Very few people do. We see 400 angels a day coming to the website. How long do they spend reading exhaustively each of the business plans? 2 minutes and 37 seconds. They want to get a flavor for what you do. You have to grab their attention. If you cannot grab your attention, 2 minutes and 37 seconds is about the amount of time it's going to take you to close your first sale as well. You're not going to be able to communicate to your client base. Once again, Americans walk out at this stage. I lecture at Harvard and MIT, each one of which spends 5 months and 7 months on the numbers in your business plan. Actually, how to write. Don't bother. Do not bother with the numbers. Once again, of the 400 angels a day, these are rich people, not desperate. Very keen to invest. Six of them. 1.5% bother to look at the numbers on the business plan. If you've been American trained or you're a VC or you've read a book on investing, then this will not resonate. But you're going to lose 80% of your money, dude. So look, that's not the audience I'm addressing. What I'm looking at, I'm not saying don't look at the numbers. Sure, look at them. They're kind of interesting. Seriously, what you think your startup's worth $4 billion bat and you've been going 7 months, that tells me a lot. It tells me that you're a fool. It tells me that I cannot trust anything that you say. You have no idea, if you're looking to raise capital right here, right now, what your cash flow is going to be in 3 weeks' time. Never mind 3 years. I tell you, that's very nice. Can I see your 3-year forecast balance sheet? No! Because you're stupid for even asking me that question. How do you think I could possibly tell you what the economy is going to be doing? What's the election next year going to throw for Thailand? What is the Vietnamese up-and-coming entrepreneurial ecosystem going to do? What's Singapore going to throw at us next? What's blockchain going to do to your business? You have no idea. What's inflation going to be? What about the currency movements? What about competitors coming? You don't know. But you're not expected. Well, you have to come up with a best kind of guess. It's kind of useful. But do not spend hours and hours on what if Excel spreadsheets unless you want to fail. And you will, because that misses the point. Once again, if an investor is excited about your business because you tell him that he is going to make 100 times money, and we get them 20 of those a day, I'm going to make 100 times money. No, you're not. No, you're not. And also, you're completely and utterly missing the point. Going back once again, see how I've cleverly dovetailed everything together? If an investor is looking to just make money on a deal, he's not a very clever investor. There are much, much easier ways to make money. If someone tells you that the best way he can think of to make money is to invest into an idea, that perhaps gives you an idea of the quality of advice he is going to give you as you move forward with your business. And then it's up to you. Entrepreneurship is all about living with your own decisions. If you think that's a good decision, that's cool. If you think crowdfunding, getting 918 people putting $237 into an account is going to give you the wisdom that you truly need, cool, go with it. But I'll tell you, you'll probably fail. There's a number of reasons, but the biggest one is that when it comes to raising your next round of money and you've disappointed, because you will disappoint, most businesses do on their first round, you look back and see the nonsense that you wrote down for your forecast sales from a year ago. Raising money at a higher level is going to kill you. It's not going to kill you. That's not true. It's going to really hurt, because the investors that have invested at 100, say, now have to invest at 70. That means they take a loss. That hurts. That hurts and begins to diminish your credibility. So we've tried 17 ways of pitching entrepreneurs in front of business angels. And there are two that work particularly well. The one that doesn't work, which seems to be prevalent across the world, is this, where I can see one person in the audience asleep and four people at the moment looking at their BlackBerries pretending that they're interested in what I'm saying. It's cool. But I'm pitching you, if I was pitching you for money and you were asleep or watching your BlackBerry, I'd be kind of upset. I'd be kind of going, whatever. I remember once in Saudi Arabia, we had six tables of investors. We had 27 investors in the room. And at one time, all 27, a 100% hit rate, they were on their phones. The people were pitching to them. All 27 of them on the phone. Now, once again, that tells you something about the investor. Do not grab the first money, the first person that offers you money. Well, you can. You might be lucky. But it's like a marriage. It's very much like a marriage. You have to have the humility to be able to understand what it is that you don't know. We've covered that. But you also have to understand the skills gap that you have. Do you know what? I'm awesome at marketing, and I'm quite good at numbers. That's great. But I cannot do SEO. I cannot do web build. I cannot do alpha, beta, and gamma. Just beyond me. So with an angel's help, or even the angel himself, he would come in and he would fill those gaps. Nothing an angel likes better than somebody saying, do you know what? I don't know how to do something. Everybody knows that you don't know how to do 100% of what it's going to take you to do a startup. If you think you can do it all yourself, you're stupid and you will die. And you'll die a horrible death. Very soon. The most efficient way that we have found to pitch businesses is what we call speed funding. So we have eight tables. Behind each table, there's one, two, three angels. No more. The entrepreneur sits down and has 4 minutes to pitch their business. 4 minutes. Some people go, no, you don't understand. My business is so very, very special. I couldn't possibly out. Get out. the average time an investor takes to read the business plan, 2 minutes and 37 seconds. A 4-minute pitch, you can do yourself a lot of damage in 4 minutes. Also, a customer is not going to wait longer than 4 minutes. He's going to get very, very bored, and he's just going to sit and look at his BlackBerry. He's going to fall asleep. He's going to do whatever it takes. He doesn't care. 4 minutes. So, some of our investors who invested in 80 or 90 deals, do you know what they tell us? They say that they have made their minds up about whether or not they are going to invest as the person is walking towards them. You're wearing glasses. Who's going to invest in somebody that's wearing glasses? You're not wearing glasses. Who's going to invest in that? You're a girl. Who's going to invest in a girl? You're a boy. That's ridiculous. You're not making eye contact with me. Why are you not making eye contact with me? You've got 1, 2, 3 seconds to give me a business card. Dude, is that how you behave in business? I'm totally out. Your breath stinks. Stinks. I don't want to sit in an office with you for 3 years with somebody with stinking breath. Because guess what? I don't need to do this. Underarm deodorant, just saying, would have been a really good idea. Anti-dandruff shampoo would have been an excellent idea. It looks like your mummy dressed you in the dark this morning. The businesses are all going to succeed. So what does it come down to? It comes down to whether or not the person thinks he will get on with you. And remember, the number one reason for him investing, the number one reason is that he is looking for something else to do with his life. He has made his money and he is now getting bored. I work in a very large bank. It's very exciting, but I've been there for 18 and a half years. And now, do you know what? I'm just thinking. Or an increasing number of people are working for multinational companies, either computer companies or FMCG companies, and they're going, do you know what, I really want out. I want out in 3-4 years' time. So what I'm going to do is invest in this business, and that is going to be my exit route. This is something I'm actually passionate about rather than selling milkshake. Nothing wrong with milkshake. It's about getting your personality across. People often ask me, what should I wear to pitch? It's a cool question, but it's the wrong question. What you should wear to pitch is whatever you want to wear. If it alienates somebody, if somebody doesn't like your shirt, they're probably not going to like your business, or they're stupid. You want to wear shorts and Crocs and flip-flops all day long? Don't pretend you're something else. Find the guy, girl, who wants to invest into a business where the founder wears Crocs and T-shirts and whatever. I don't like the fact that you're wearing Crocs and T-shirts. I don't care. Tough. That's what I am. It's about being yourself. I judged a business plan competition in Geneva, in Switzerland, and it was one of the world's top incubators, and they're all over the world, and this was the best of the best deals. So it was the best of the best deals. It was a $200,000 prize to the people that won. And there was a whole bunch of Americans there, and they weren't even looking at the screens. They knew when the slides were going to change. It was all about the slides. It was all about the numbers. It was cool. Really, really good. Then a guy turned up, and he was going, "Ah, look, I'm really sorry. I've got a hangover. I've got a really bad hangover. In fact, I missed my plane this morning to Geneva. You know, I just left it overnight. In fact, this is what I was wearing last night to go out, so I'm really sorry. Anyway, look, you know, I know I've got a 10-minute pitch. Here's my pitch. It's an inflatable cot for babies that you use in Africa. I'm going to save probably 28,000 lives in the next year. Oxfam's on board. That's all I've got to say. Thank you very much. Guess he won the prize. He was genuine. People do get hangovers. People do make mistakes. Did he have a good business? Yes, he did. Had he got people on board? Did he have revenue? Yes, he did. He cut all the boxes. Did he waste their time? No. The best 4-minute pitch that we have is, hi, my name's Bill. I'm looking for $120,000 for a 12% stake in my business that does alpha, beta, gamma. Is that the sort of thing you'd be interested in? Bit risky. Bit risky. But you know what? Rather than you arrogantly telling them what it is that you think they want to hear, you know what I'd rather have as an angel is some dialogue, is actually a conversation, asking them the questions that you want to have answered. So that was a 12-minute pitch, so a 12-second pitch, and you've got another 3 minutes and 48 seconds left for me to talk about things. And then it's how you handle those questions. If you handle the questions aggressively, they're probably not going to invest. If you answer the questions with stupid answers, do you know what? They're probably not going... Do you have a competitive advantage in the marketplace? Do you have something which somebody else does not have, and have you got it protected? Do you have copyright? Do you have a patent? Do you have a trademark? Do you have first mover advantage? Do you have some intellectual skills that nobody else could have? If you do not have those things, you do not have a business, and no one is going to invest. Why is no one going to invest? Because it is incumbent on the shareholders of Google to move into your market and kill you. Thank you very much for proving the market. It's very kind of you. Now we're going to do it much better, and we're bigger than you. Welcome to the world of business. Nothing wrong with that, but nobody said it was going to be fair. So many businesses that we see do not have a competitive advantage. Don't have anything. I mean, they've got something, but they've got nothing that they can actually protect against somebody else coming in. Alibaba wants to do it, Alibaba's going to do it. And they'll do it better than you. And thanks for giving us the idea. I know this is Thailand. I know there's no point asking you questions because you won't answer. So I'll answer it. Setting up a business is incredibly straightforward. It is relatively easy. The most difficult thing about setting up a business is staying in business, is actually having what it takes, is being, man, that sounds really simple, but having an idea, I hope I've impressed upon you that that's not a business. Having an idea that actually has processes and controls is going to be a business and will attract funding. But that's not it all either. The bigger part of it is that you need to work on 16 hours Saturdays. You need to work on Sundays. I spent the last 6 months, I've had 3 days off, including weekends. And why? Because I'm stupid, but more importantly, because I'm passionate about what I do. If you guys are thinking of setting up a startup and you are not passionate about what it is that you do, don't bother. Just give in right now, because you will not make it. You have to find something that interests you, something that interests you so much that you're passionate about it, something that people actually want to buy. Call me old-fashioned. I've come up with an app that produces baby kangaroos in my bedroom. Wow, that is so cool. Yep, I have cracked the kangaroo genome. I've got its DNA. Dude, that is incredible. That's really cool. Just a tiny, tiny little question. Tiny question. Does anybody want kangaroos in their bed? I'm just saying. Does anybody want... Oh, but you don't understand how brilliant it is. It's brilliant. Yep. Somebody else is going to come in and do it all the better. I'm getting to the end. You'll be pleased to hear. He nodded. That hurts, man. That hurts. We've been going 9 years. We're in 10 countries. 94% of all the startups that we have ever funded are still growing. 94%. Producing an average 42% return for the investors that are looking to do it. Even I'm impressed. You look at the American model and you see that 80% of startups are going to fail. I hope that I have impressed upon you what the difference is. The difference is to not go for funding too early, to have that competitive advantage, and then to seek it from somebody who can add value to your business. Well, hey, well, you don't have to. You could seek it from anybody. But one of the reasons that half of the reason that the businesses are still going is that we understood, and it took us 22 months to figure it out, but actually what the motivation of these people really was. You've got a good business idea, you've got it protected, you can communicate it effectively. Fantastic. You're not spending too much time on the numbers, although the numbers look realistic. That's groovy. The guy gets that. The guy is buying into you as a person. He is looking into your soul. When they do due diligence, i.e. they come and look at what you've got and they test to see you've got the books and whatever, what is that really about? What that really is about is actually how do I get on with you as a person? Are you going to be able to help me do the things I want to do with my life? Because frankly, I'm a bit bored, or yeah, that'll do. You get the gist. The other half of it, and this took us 26 months to figure out, is that just because you're rich, and now I'm talking about the angels, just because you're rich doesn't necessarily mean you know how to value your business. Just because you're rich doesn't necessarily mean you know how to do due diligence, how to look at a company and see if it's a good company. Just because you're rich doesn't necessarily... Oh, cool. Thank God. He's pleased. Doesn't necessarily mean that you know how to do that. So across the world, we train angels. We train high net worths how to be business angels, because it's not intuitive. People don't just necessarily, because you made your money in retail, because you made your money in banking. We ran 2 weeks ago, we had a session with Goldman Sachs, and they brought along banana derivatives, swaption traders, and masters of the universe. These guys were multi-millionaires. The reason that they will become good angel investors is that they had the humility to actually go, I might be a master of the universe up here, but I have no idea. I've got some idea, but I really need some help in terms of how to do that. So we super is up. Thank you, translators. I love you. Thanks, guys.